All right, and now in part five, we're going to think about how we take everything we've talked about in this module and summarize it into a graph to help guide our decision making. So we've talked about how do we select appropriate behaviors, we've defined them operationally, we've figured out, we've refined that definition even further using the dimensions of behavior. We just spent some time thinking about the different ways we can measure that based on which dimension we're most interested in. And then in this last section, we're just going to look at some quick ways to graph this information, because graphing is a really great way to help us make decisions with our data. All right, so there are lots of different reasons that we're going to take the time to graph our data or to turn it into a visual display. First is that it gives us just immediate access to an ongoing visual record. It lets us just know quickly what's going on. Are there changes in behavior? Second, it helps us explore variations. So we might notice patterns in the behavior when we take time to graph it that we wouldn't notice if we're just living it day to day. Things like, oh, behavior spikes on Wednesday every week. We can see that pattern when we graph it out, but we might not see it if we don't take the time to graph it. Third, it just aids in the interpretation of data. So we can see really quickly and easily whether things are getting better or worse or staying the same. We can identify when we need to make changes in our intervention really quickly. Visual analysis is also a really conservative way to measure the significance of a behavior change. So if you're into research or if you've read research studies and you've seen things like statistically significant findings, we can find statistically significant findings that are not actually important in a student's real life. When we use visual analysis, we can see the magnitude of change in a really clear way, and we can see whether that change is big enough to actually be important for the student. So we might see like, oh yeah, the behavior changed, but only a tiny little bit. It's not enough to make a difference. We need to do something different with our intervention. So it helps us see the magnitude of behavior change really clearly. It allows independent judgments. More than one person can look at the same graph and likely make the same judgment about what's going on and make similar interpretations. And it's a really effective source of feedback for the individuals or the students as well. When we see our own data graphed out, it helps us modify our own behavior and it helps motivate us to try to change our behavior as well. And so it's a really effective source of feedback. So there's lots of reasons to graph the data that you collect. We're going to think about which graph you might choose, again, based on what we're trying to summarize. So you might use a line graph if you're trying to show changes in behavior across time. You might use a bar graph or a circle graph if you're trying to show behaviors that are in categories. Or this is a really great time to summarize the percent of antecedent or consequence events that a student was presented with if you were collecting ABC information or something like that. So if you've got data that are in categories, use a bar graph or a pie graph. If you've got data across time, use a line graph. This quick summary chart will give you some quick information about how to summarize based on the type of measurement system that you chose. So if you chose an anecdotal report, probably going to use a narrative description. If you're looking at a tally or a count, you can summarize by the number of events, you can turn it into a rate, or you can even use it as a number or percent in each category. So those are the different options for what your summary score would be that you put in a graph. Here are some line graph conventions, and there's a lot of information that you can look at for this. These are just a couple of quick ideas to help you quickly interpret line graphs that you might encounter or help create ones that really aid instruction. So as we said, line graphs are really great ways to summarize information across time. They help you see patterns really quickly and easily. Generally, they have the unit of time going across the bottom and the frequency or the rate or the percent of intervals going up the y-axis. You can also look at things like drawing this dashed line down the middle to show when an intervention happened. So we've got a baseline phase where we're just looking at the student's behavior. We then change something about what we're doing to support the student. We want to know whether behavior changes after that. We can just draw a phase line and quickly and easily compare the change in behavior from before the intervention until after the intervention. We want to stick a title on there so we know what it is that we're measuring. The data point is a little dot. We can connect those with lines in between to show continuous data. And we want to make sure we put the dimension of behavior on the y-axis and the time variable on the x-axis. The phase line, as we said, shows when we did something new. When we're looking at developing pie graphs, again, these are useful for representing percentages of things, so percentages of intervals or events or individuals that fall into certain categories. We often use this to summarize ABC information, So what percent of the behavior occurred during independent work time versus small group time versus large group time would be a really great way to summarize that. A circle graph or a pie graph would be a really great way to summarize that information. And bar graphs are used for very similar things as pie graphs. These are really interchangeable in a lot of different ways. Same thing, we can use them to summarize things that fall into certain categories. They can also be used to show information across time when there's lots of different data paths, or it would be too confusing to put it all in a line graph. A bar graph might be a way to show data across time as well. So here's some examples, simple ones. Here's some antecedent events. Here's some consequence events. Again, helps us clearly see what's the pattern of behavior. This behavior most often happens during independent work time and most frequently is followed by adult attention. So we can understand what's going on really quickly and easily by looking at these graphs. We're going to ask you to now take a minute to do this stop and jot activity. Go back to the behavior and the measurement system that you've been working on throughout this whole module. So most recently in activity 6.5, you chose a measurement system that aligned with the dimension of behavior that you had operationally defined. Based on the measurement system that you chose, identify an appropriate type of graph and just sketch out what the hypothetical data might look like for a student in your class. Just practice developing the graph. Which graphing features would you include and why? Remember to think carefully about how to maximize the interpretation of your data. So take a minute, pause the video, and complete that, and we'll come back together in just a minute. All right, welcome back. Hope you were able to develop quick graphs that matched the measurement system that you had chosen. Remember, we're going to most often use a line graph when we have data across time, and we're going to most often use a bar graph or a pie graph if we have categories of information. So now we want to bring this whole module together with one quick example. So let's think about a particular student. Kelly is a student who's often off task. In addition, she's gotten into trouble for talking out and walking out of the room without permission. So now we've got a couple of different behaviors going on. Think back about the content that we've covered in this module. How would you know which behaviors to take data on? Are some of these behaviors higher priority than others? Think back to the very beginning, part one of this module, to help you decide. Which dimensions would you choose for each of these behaviors and why? And based on that, how would you collect that data? Who would take the data, and what measurement system might you use? Here's one possible approach. There's more than one answer to those questions. As you can see moving your way through this module, there's a variety of different ways that you can approach this, but here's one example that we've used. You could consider estimating how much time Kelly was off task and counting or getting a frequency of the number of talkouts or walkouts when she talks out and interrupts instruction or leaves the classroom. And in this case, her teacher is going to need to be able to collect the data, so we need to make sure it's really feasible for the teacher. So here's an example of a measurement system that we could put together. We take our observation period and we break it up into intervals, and we're going to use momentary time sampling for the off-task behavior. So in this case, at the end of each interval, the teacher is simply going to look up and say, is Kelly off task? If yes, she's going to put a plus or a check in the box. That's it. On the bottom part here, we can record a tally of the number of times she talks out or the number of times she walks out of the classroom. So in this situation, if the teacher notices that Kelly walked out of the classroom, just a quick tally mark, and that event is recorded, and she's all set. So it's a pretty simple measurement system that actually gets at all three of those behaviors in a pretty feasible way. We then take that information and we can graph that to help us understand what's going on for Kelly. So this is the percent of intervals that Kelly was off task in our particular example. So there were three observations. She was off task 70% of intervals, about 40% of intervals, and back up to about 60% of intervals. So we can put this information in a line graph because we're summarizing data across time. And then we can use this information to help guide our decision making. So if you are currently implementing a plan to improve Kelly's off-task behavior and this were her data, would you change the plan? There's more than one answer to that, but probably your answer is you don't know yet. That we need to be thinking about the pattern of behavior. We might not have enough data points yet, and there's not a clear trend here. It got better, it got worse, it got better again. We don't really know what it's going to look like across time. In the next module, we're going to spend a little bit more time thinking about how we're going to use data to guide our decision making. So we're really just trying to get you thinking about, based on this data, what would you do differently? And we're going to spend more time looking at that in the next module when we come back.